Welcome back to another season of the Future Report podcast. We are delighted that you have joined us again for more episodes about trends, about the future, and interpreting how the world around us is changing. As it's a new year, we thought we would begin by exploring how we can go about understanding and interpreting the world around us. And this has all come off the back of our top trends of 2023 event, which we have just conducted, so it's hot off the press. And joining me today to chat through how we can respond strategically to the changing times and the changing trends is Mark McCrindle. Mark, welcome back to the podcast.
Thanks, Ash. Good to be here for another season ahead.
It's the beginning of a new year. How has the start to your 2023 been? I know you've been speaking out at events. It's been a busy January for you. What sort of events have you been out and about speaking at?
Mainly education events, as schools get back up and particularly teachers get back in the zone and have those professional development days where they, you know, get themselves in the frame before the students arrive, and we get the great privilege of being able to present to teachers at these days and share a few insights as they get ready for the students.
Yeah, our whole team has been out and about. I mean, you've taken probably most of the inquiries and the engagements. I know you've done a few interstate. I did one just this past week as well. It is a real privilege, and it's great to see so many educators particularly excited for a new year. They're well rested at this point. And it's been great to have a lot of conversations about what they think the trends will be, particularly, I guess, pertaining to their sector and their industry. What have you observed, Mark, in terms of any themes or topics? Because we've been doing more than just professional development days. We've been delivering media commentary. We've been already, you know, busy the last few, you know, weeks of 2023, analyzing studies and surveys. Have you had any particular themes or topics that have kind of stood out to you at the start of this year?
Yeah, well, if we just think about those education events, and as you said, the whole team has been out speaking to staffs of schools, and I think we counted six cities across four states, so a lot's been going on. A lot of the trends we analyze, when we get to talk to principals and teachers themselves, we find they're really experiencing them firsthand. Take, for example, the relocation of people since the pandemic, where people have moved to regional areas, they've taken their jobs with them, perhaps out of the capital cities. And I was just up at a school in Cessnock, great little school, and they have said that the growth they've seen in student enrollments just in the last few months, and indeed, the principal was saying she had about 25 people contact her in the week before school began to say, can we enroll our children? Is it too late? So this massive move, even to small regional areas, is hitting schools and hitting enrollments. And at the same time, the ongoing skill shortage. And if we think about teachers, teacher shortage, you know, there's just been a reset across all these industries and sectors, and you know, growth in schools, and yet a challenge in filling those gaps. And, you know, teachers have been experiencing this sea change and tree change as well. And so principals really have been scrambling to fill those positions. So for any listeners out there, if you've got kids and, you know, you're hearing from them that classes that last year had 12 or 15 students now have 30 students, that's the reality. As schools are getting by with fewer teachers just until they fill those gaps. So many schools have gaps. And then you add to that Generation Alpha beginning high school this year, and we've been tracking them, Ash, for a long time, and you and I writing about them. And now these children are hitting the high school, turning teenagers. That's been of real interest to the society, and particularly to schools. And then you throw in the AI trends that we've been, again, tracking all these technology trends, and now ChatGPT as just one of those little new technologies where, you know, AI is, in very human-sounding way, able to compile answers, and it's really causing ructions for teachers. How do we conduct assessments now when we're not even sure if the student has submitted that work, if it's come from AI? You know, all the trends we look at, demographic, generational, social, technological, are all, you know, being experienced by schools, and we're hearing the feedback as we get out there. So it just shows the real world reality of the trends analysis.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think Even beyond education, I know that you've been doing a fair bit of consulting around Generation Alpha this year. And again, it's been something that I guess as this generation get older, more and more organizations are realizing that they're not just future consumers, but they're current consumers, especially as the oldest of them, you know, reach their teenage years. And even for me, in some of the presentations I've delivered, teachers are like, oh yeah, especially high school teachers are saying, yeah, these are our students now. Like they're not just going to be here in a few years. They're already here. So yeah. And I mean, ChatGPT is on the minds and lips of, yeah, I imagine every educator, even beyond, you know, high school, it's tertiary. It's really going to shake up that industry, among others as well. So very interesting times. And I mean, we are always looking at the trends and we're always excited by them. But I think particularly because we have just had our top trends of 2023 virtual event where we had hundreds of people tune in across Australia and beyond to hear about our predictions for this year and based on a study that we conducted as well as scoping of other trends and just more broadly what's been shaping the last few years and what we predict will have big impacts this year. And as I mentioned, part of that the research for that was a study that we conducted just a few weeks ago. So it's been a very busy January for our team. I feel like, you know, we often say the world comes back after Australia Day. Well, we've been back at it for quite a few weeks now. But Mark, from this survey, we did ask some questions about people's sentiment and how they feel about the trends in 2023 and change. Was there any particular insights that stood out to you there about how people are feeling at the beginning of this year?
Well, on the positive news, it was great to see that more Australians are entering this year with a positive outlook than a negative one. When we asked, how's this year, do you think going to compare to last year? 36% said much more or somewhat more positive, and just 19% much less or somewhat less positive than the last year that they've had. So more likely to say things are looking up than things are looking down. Mind you, we have come through some pretty tough years, so it's all from a pretty low base. But but the younger generation were even more likely. 59% of Gen Z said they think the year ahead will be better than the last one. So that's good. But probably what needs to be said in the same breath is the uncertainty that Australians have when we drill down to particular issues. So we said, all right, are you concerned at all about a resurging or a new pandemic? You know, we still bear the scars of the last few years. 40% said extremely very concerned about this, compared to 29% who said it's of no real concern. So more likely to be concerned. And the Gen Zs, almost half, 46% said, you know what, the pandemic, a resurgence or a new one, is definitely an extreme or high concern. Even higher than that was rising interest rates. And this is a global phenomenon at the moment, and rightly so. 57% in this survey of 1,000 people said, I'm extremely very concerned about it. And Generation Z in their 20s, as they really are looking at that housing market or looking at the rental market, even more likely to be concerned. Almost three quarters, 73% of them said extremely very concerned about rising interest rates. And then you add to that global recession, and you've got around 60% saying extremely or very concerned about that. Rising cost of living, almost four in five people, 79% said, I'm extremely or very concerned about those costs. Inflation really biting, the household budget not quite stretching to meet those needs. Things much more expensive than they were a year ago. And Generation Z even more acutely feeling this. 83% said extremely or very concerned. Those that said no real concern about cost of living was just a single digit. It was very small indeed. So it tells us a story of, while there's hope for the year ahead in these particular issues of global uncertainty, potential global recessions, certainly local rising costs of living and interest rates, the inflation pressures and housing challenges, these are front of mind issues for people at the moment, for households, and even more so Generation Z. So that's just the reality of the year ahead.
Yeah, it's really interesting for us to, I guess, use research to test our hypothesis on these things. And we were, I think, reflecting on some of these results just off mic and in regards to the event that we're running, or that we've just conducted actually, and just about how tuned into the global context everyone is, I think more so than maybe in the past and in light of the last couple of years especially. So it is an interesting time and interesting to always, yeah, get some of those numbers to see where people are at. Mark, you had a really helpful role in our event. You kind of set the scene and the context for it. Jeff Braley and I both presented some insights about the actual trends, and we, spoiler alert, we aren't going to talk about those in today's episode. We're going to save that for one very fast approaching episode that we will record on those trends. But we wanted to really today delve into that context that you painted in that opener, because you painted this really great picture. And I know that you used a boat metaphor to describe this idea of trends and our response and the context. And, you know, it does remind me of about a year ago, I think now, our team went out sailing for one of our team days, and it was on the beautiful Sydney Harbour, and it was a stunning day. It was great. I thought, oh, this is going to be great. Like, it's going to be a relaxing day sailing. And it wasn't that relaxing. It was like everyone was out there pulling their weight, you know, learning on the fly. And it really did highlight the need and the role that teamwork played and communication. It was, you know, it was fun, but it was also like very metaphorical. So I wondered if you could just take a moment to explain this metaphor that you shared in the event about the impact of the trends and the winds of change that impact us and those kind of directing the boat and what our response should be. So could you talk us through that?
Yeah, sure. Well, you know, the sailing boat is a useful metaphor for our organizations as we sail through winds of change, as we face headwinds ahead, as we deal with uncertain seas and waves upon us and all of that. And, you know, it's great you bring up the boat that we went out on, the sailing boat. And that's my memory too. It was hard work. You know, we're nonstop trimming the sails or adjusting them as the wind shifts or as we shift in response to the direction we want to head. And that was really what the metaphor was about, that the winds hitting us are like the trends. Now, that old saying is so true. We can't adjust the direction of the wind, but we can change the set of our sail. And that is the strategic response that we have to bring to the trends, to the winds that blow our way. We ought not be worried by those trends or winds. We ought not be intimidated by them. That's what you get out there on a boat. You get wind. And without the wind, we'd have a problem. But with the wind blowing, we can adjust the trim and the set of the sail and so steer that boat at the speed that's appropriate and move forward. But I said, it's not just as simple as observing the trends and then adjusting the sails. And by the way, I'll say to our listeners, you know, tune into the trends discussion, because the eight trends, Ash, that you and Jeff delivered were fantastic. You know, really complex trends, transformative trends and global ones. And I know the listeners will love to hear those. So they're the winds. They're global and they're fast changing. And they're important that we understand them so we can adjust the sail. But we adjust the sail based on another key factor, and that is our context. And that's where the boat is, how the boat's performing, and where we want to get to. I talked about three key things, and the first of those was, what's the condition of the boat? Because if the boat is in good condition, then we might, you know, be a bit more aggressive as we deal with the winds and sail close to the winds. If the boat is not as strong, we might be a bit more conservative there. And the boat condition is the organizational risk profile. So we've got to understand that. And I can talk through that in a bit. But secondly, it's understanding not just the boat condition, but the crew condition. How are they going? And are they up for a bit of a challenge, or are they just sort of a little bit attitudinally unsure of the future, in which case we'll need to work with them, and that's also going to adjust our response. So we looked at crew attitude, and that's another way of saying the change sentiment. What's our attitude as a team to change and to trend? And we can talk through that. And once we know from a context perspective the condition of the boat, that's our risk profile as an organization, and the crew attitude, that's our sentiment to change as a team, our attitude towards change, we can then look at our strategic objectives, which is like the destination we want to get to and the time frames we have set. And based on all of those factors, we'll adjust the sails in response to the trends, knowing our context, and get to our goal. That's what it's all about.
Yeah, it was a really helpful, I think, picture that you painted there, Mark. And like you mentioned there, the context within which organisations are operating is really important. We have been talking about this. I'm sure people have heard it before on the podcast. And we often see our role at McCrindle as helping organisations understand that context more broadly, externally, but also even within. So let's just unpack that for a moment. The conditions of the boat, one of them being the organisational risk profile. What are some ways that you would recommend organisations measure their risk profile or their appetite for risk?
Well, there's three key areas there that show us as an organisation how we're travelling, and they're all areas of capital. There's the financial capital, and this is the bread and butter of businesses. So they understand their finances, they have their profit and loss, they have their balance sheet, they've got the financial analysis, and that's normally what is looked at, the financials. But that's just one area of capital. That might be going strong, but what about the customer capital? In other words, understanding the market research, engaging with the customers, seeing how connected they are, understanding the competitor landscape. Are we seeing a bit of a drift with customer? Are we seeing that they're not as highly rating our goods or services as they used to? So while the capital may be in good state, if the customers are drifting or not as engaged, that's going to be a good portent for the future and show how our boat is performing. But maybe the boat condition is very strong from a financial capital and a customer or brand capital. You know, maybe we're really locked in there. Well, the third factor is the social capital, you know, community capital. How are we viewed out there? We are in an era where social license to operate matters, where non-customers can have increased leverage on how an organization is perceived. Our brand is in the hands not just of our customers now, but the broader public. And if we have issues around perhaps supply chain or ESG, environment, social and governance, if we're not doing the right community audit or social audit and find that we're actually not aware that we're not in good state from an external perspective, then that's going to impair us and therefore show the boat is not in the best condition to tackle some headwinds ahead. So it's all of those areas of capital that will give us a sense of how we are traveling from a boat condition perspective. The risk profile comes from our financial capital, our customer capital, and our social capital. And all of that can be researched. We've got accountants for the financial side of things, but hopefully we've got the good customer knowledge and customer research, and hopefully we can do some social audits to know how we're traveling from an external perspective as well.
Yeah, they're such really, really important areas for organizational leaders, particularly, I guess, at that strategic level to be aware of. So that's the risk profile part of the boat condition. You mentioned there, I guess, the second part of this boat context is the team change sentiment, or the conditions of the crew, if we go along the metaphor. How would you recommend, or what advice would you give to someone who is thinking, okay, I need to investigate like how open to change my team is? Is that what you mean by team change sentiment?
Exactly. Their outlook to the change and the trends. So, you know, the boat might be in good condition based on the capital that we just looked at. But what about the team? Because if the team are exhausted or uncertain, if there's a lot of anxiety, then again, that's going to adjust our strategic response. And so we measure this through a change sentiment. What is the attitude of our team to change? And it's got two axes. You know, the horizontal axis looks at the sense to which we feel that we can bring about change, agency, we call it. And some people feel that while they might be able to bring about change in their own life, they're not sure how they can change their organization, or they're not sure how they can change and bring about impacts in their society or community. And so that's a key measure. And there are some that are low on that. And if that's the case, then I'd help them see how small changes and decisions that they make or the organization makes can bring about change, show the wins, highlight the impacts, celebrate the results, and show how it's been the team and the individual aspects that have been able to bring about results. But the vertical axis, and all of this people can get from our report, from our infographic, or indeed from the event that we held, all of that is accessible. Is the perspective of trends. So some people are optimistic when they look to the future and trends and change, and others take a more pessimistic view of the changes ahead. And so those two axes will give different quadrants, we looked at four possible outcomes. And so firstly, you've got those who don't think they can bring about change and are pretty negative about the outlook anyway, and we'd call those fatalists. You know, they're sort of victims of the trends and don't feel they can make an impact there. We also quantified the proportion of the population in these, but you know, just under one-fifth of the population are in that category. And then you've got those that are negative in outlook, but they believe they can bring about change, and we call those the activists. They're sort of like fatalists in the outlook in terms of negative perspective, but activists in terms of action, because they believe that they can bring about change. They do believe they've got high agency. That's why they're activists, because they want to change the negative outlook that they see. They want to bring about positive change. And the other, the third of the quadrants, so they're high in terms of positive outlook, but low in terms of their ability to impact. We call them the optimists. They're on there for the ride. It's going to be a good sunny ride. They can't change it anyway, but that's where they sit. And then you got the fourth quadrant. They're high in both axes. They're high in agency. They feel they can have impacts, and high in their positive outlook. They think the future will be bright. And we call those the futurists. And they chart a way to the future in a very positive way. Now, you know, each quadrant has some downsides, and even the futurists do. They're high on both of those. They're glass half full, and they believe they can bring about change, but they need to reflect on the fact that actually negative outcomes can sometimes arise, and uncertain events, not just positive ones, you know, threats and challenges, not just opportunities and benefits come their way. And so they've got to prepare for the rainy day, not just the sunshine ahead. So they were the quadrants, they were the axes. And by understanding where our team lies on that particular metric, will help us know how we need to communicate, whether we need to show more wins or show the impacts or drive up the agency knowledge, or even build a little bit more positivity into the team so they can take some action. But that is the team change sentiment tool that we've developed.
Mm. Mark, do you have any, I guess, suspicions or hunches around where you think most people, what quadrant you think most people would fit into?
Well, from the research, we found most people are the futurists, which is great. Positive in outlook, upbeat in the impacts they can make. But the next biggest were the activists. So positive in impact, but negative in outlook. And whether we've got futurists or activists, you know, they're both going to bring about change. It's just some are half full and the others half empty. Optimists were pretty big as well. More than a quarter of the population are positive in their expectations for the future, not really sure that they can bring about change. And then the fatalists, as I said, about one-fifth. So that's how it lies in the population from our study. But we did encourage people in the discussion that we had to work with the team they've got. If there are a lot of activists there, that's great. But, you know, they need to recognize that there are also opportunities and strengths, not just look at everything with a dour, you know, clouds on the horizon perspective. And even the fatalists, you know, they're not true fatalists because they've got a job, they've finished education, they're making decisions in their life, they bring about outcomes. It's just maybe from a social or organizational perspective, they don't think they can bring about change. So I would say, well, look, let's look at the personal impacts they have and how they bring about change. Those same techniques or strategies can be applied to their role or organization to bring about change there as well. So we do have agency, and the same agency we have in our personal lives, we can apply to our organizational roles and also bring about change. So wherever we sit, there are some solutions to be borne out. But the starting point is to do a bit of a team change sentiment audit to know where the team are at and know what the solutions you need to bring about are.
Yeah, I found it really interesting when you were explaining this, and even when we conducted the research, just around even reflecting on where I think I sit, like which quadrant would I fit into, and then even thinking about like the team that we have here and my colleagues, like if I had to make an informed opinion about which quadrant they're in, you know, without, you know, running the survey among our own team. But that's something that I think it's probably helpful for people to reflect on, especially leaders, whether they make assumptions or conduct the survey of their own staff, just to see how the sentiment is among their team and see where they're at. And like you said, not just how they are coping, but how they're feeling about, yeah, internal and external sort of trends, and that agency around, you know, how they can influence or respond to it is really helpful. And as you've mentioned, Mark, we've got quite a lot of visuals here that we're talking through. And in our event, we had a lot of slides, as we often do. So I thought I'd just make mention of to people if they're interested, anyone listening, you know, you are able to go and find the event recording that we shared online. You can register for that and purchase a ticket to watch that. And so you can find that at McCrindle.com/resources. If anyone is interested in kind of maybe not just hearing us explain these ideas, but actually seeing all the visuals and some of the extra data that we had. But the last component, I guess, of the context of the boat that you mentioned, Mark, is the direction. And I guess this refers to a bit more of that strategy and that strategic objectives that an organization has. How important do you think it is, this strategic direction, that it is for people and organizations to take time out to invest in? How important do you think it is?
Yeah, I mean, it's essential, you know. So again, the boat is there and we're feeling the winds, we're adjusting the sail based on the context, which is the condition of the boat. So we looked at the capital, how much we've got in reserve. We looked at the crew, we're checking in on them. We know their attitude now in terms of change and outlook. And so the third factor that's going to adjust the sails is where do we want to go and when do we want to get there? And those strategic objectives, the strategic plan is essential. And I would say two things there to keep in mind to our listeners. Firstly, let's make sure that strategic plan is developed not just from the top and then deployed down. That is the normal way. You know, we have the board decide on what the strategic objectives are, or maybe it's management and executive there as well, and then it's given to the team to execute. Now, if we want engagement, and particularly with the next generation coming on board, they need to be consulted. They want a seat at the table. They need to, if they're going to deliver on this plan, they surely want a voice into it. So these days, you know, we're seeing change there. And when it comes to strategic planning processes, we're seeing far more of a consultation approach. And that's so important to get the team to give input into that. After all, they all need to own it. The second thing I would say is that once we've determined that strategic plan, we've gone through the strategy planning process, we've consulted and got the views of others. Sure, you know, it's being led from the top because that's where the responsibility lies, but we've been collaborative in approach. Let's make sure we're really clear on the communication of it, because one of the big problems we have and one of the reasons that we don't get to our destination or we don't get there on time is that we've got a great strat plan, but we haven't communicated it right through the organization. We haven't communicated clearly. We haven't communicated what everyone's role in delivering on that plan really is. Or maybe they know their role, but they're just not being celebrated. And all of that is part of the communications process. So let's be really clear on what the objectives are, on what that means for individuals within the organization. Every person on the boat has a role. We're all on the ropes. That's what we found when we were out there sailing Sydney Harbour. Someone's on the steering wheel, and even that swaps. Others are on ropes. Others are packing away or preparing for the next sail to go up. That's what it needs to be in an organization. And when you get to the destination, or maybe when you just pass the next turn point and achieve that leg of success, you celebrate and it's high fives and it's well done. And I think if we could be consultative in our strategy planning process and clearly communicate and show the roles that we all have to play and celebrate those inputs, I think we're far more likely to get to our destination as a team and get there in a good state as well.
Fantastic insights from you, Mark. It was really interesting, actually, just on that strategic direction component. We asked in our Trends of 2023 event, I mean, it would be amiss of us if we didn't conduct some polls within the event as we're transitioning between speakers. We polled the audience members of our event and we said, using the boat metaphor, which of the following areas needs attention in your organization in 2023? A, the boat condition, which is the organization risk profile, and 20% of our audience said that was what needed their attention. B, the crew attitude, which is the team change sentiment, and that was 30%. Or C, the destination, which is the strategic objectives, and 50% of attendees said that. So it was really that third component, which many of the people who attended our event said that's probably where we need to focus for 2023. And that's something that we really love to partner with organizations on, whether it's conducting a big research piece to understand those and inform the strategic objectives, or whether it's running a strategic planning session. We've been delving a lot into that space over the last few years, and it's very rewarding. And I know that you've got a lot of strategic sort of roles that you play, Mark, not just with McCrindle, but advising other organizations at that board level as well. So it's super important part of the process. So
Yeah, well, exactly. And we just want to see those sailing boats out there on the water deal with the winds of change and the waves and get to those destinations, not only in a good state and survive, you know, and thrive, but to make sure the crew get there in good condition as well. That's what we're about, flourishing. And as you find on the boat, you get to the destination and you feel pretty good. And that's our hope for every organisation, every leader listening.
Yeah, fantastic insights from you, Mark, today in the podcast. Great summary of that introduction that you delivered at the Trends event. And as I mentioned, we will be delivering a podcast episode about the trends themselves. So stay tuned for that, as well as some other really exciting episodes we've got planned for the remainder of this season as we commence a new year. So once again, Mark, a delight to have you on. Thanks so much for your time and expertise.
Thanks, Ash.
And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can subscribe to the podcast, you can follow us on social media, you can head to McCrindle.com. And as I mentioned, for the actual trends event, you can head to McCrindle.com/resources and you'll find how you can access that event there. So as always, thanks again for listening to the Future Report podcast, and bye for now.